Hi, I'm Dr. Manoli Manilikakis from Advanced Facial Surgery, and you're listening to PBR Podcast.
Hit it!
What's up, everybody? PBR Podcast, Mike Pilano, Derek D, and sitting in our first doctor, the first doctor we've had on the show, right?
The doctor.
Very first one, yeah.
The doctor. We're just going to call him the doctor. Dr. Manoli Manilikakis, thank you so much for coming on, man.
Thanks for having me, gentlemen.
No problem at all, man. Appreciate it.
Nice this meeting you, Derek.
You too. This is an impressive resume. Let me just, so undergraduate at BU.
Yes.
Oh, you're going to jump right in.
Well, I just want to
jump right in.
Just give a quick.
I like it.
Yeah, and so you went to you went to Rutgers.
Yes.
And you went
to dental school first.
So you're a dentist?
Well, I dentist by trade, yes. I went to dental school for 4 years. And after dental school, that's where I left dentistry behind.
And you went to oral?
And I went to oral and maxillofacial surgery, which is a really complex type of specialty of dentistry. But basically, it's anything from the clavicles up, reconstruction, aesthetic, cancer surgery.
Wow.
Dental implants, extraction of wisdom teeth. So you name it, it covers it pretty much from the neck up.
It's
kind of
crazy.
Columbus, Mississippi for my fellowship in facial
cosmetic surgery.
Jeez, yeah. You got like 40 years of school.
Right. If you're watching this on YouTube and you can see, like, normally we have comedians and actors on where our notes are really like, make people laugh, tell fart jokes, right? And look at this from Dr. Manol. So we're so excited to have our first doctor on. And it's going to be a little bit of a game changer from our last episode with the Reverend Bob Levy and Twitchells. Yeah. But you never know where it goes, and that's what it's all about.
I'm honored to be here, and I'm actually humbled actually being asked. So thank you guys.
Thanks for coming. Right at the top of the episode, tell anybody who's listening. Sometimes when you're listening to an interview and you don't know somebody and you want to know them and you want to see what they look like, where can they stalk you on social media?
Social media, you can find me at Dr. Manoli. That's on Twitter. Then you can also catch me on Advanced Facial Surgery on Facebook, and on Instagram, it's Dr. Manilikakis.
His name's awesome, by the way. Manoli Manilikakis. Manoli Manilikakis. I said that right?
Say that when you're 5 years old trying to get through grade school.
You said it right, which is impressive.
Dr.
Man.
Manoli Manilikakis.
Yeah.
Dr. Manoli Manilikakis. Yo, Dr. Manoli, hand me that cannoli. You like the extra bowl?
You're just going to rhyme his name into things? Is that what we do here?
That just sounds fun.
So, doctor.
Yes.
Can I call you doctor?
You call me whatever you want,
man. You want to call me doctor now?
No, you don't have to call me doctor. That's crazy, man.
Is it?
Yeah, man.
What's up, doc?
Yeah, exactly.
See how he winked at the camera.
That's good.
He's like, he definitely wants to call a doctor. So, let's get right into it real quick. You basically do plastic surgery.
Yes. Well, I don't call it plastic surgery because that's a specialty. I actually call it cosmetic surgery.
Okay.
So that's more appropriate to, because I'm not a plastic surgeon. I'm actually an oral and maxillofacial surgeon who does cosmetic surgery. And there are plastic surgeons who do cosmetic surgeries as well. But, you know, there's reconstructive surgery, there's cosmetic. And the only reason I kind of point that out is because it is a kind of a sticking point with certain other specialties,
Okay.
There's rivals all over.
Sure, I bet.
Oh, I'm sure. Everything. I mean,
turf.
Wait, and you said you live in the city, New York City.
Yeah.
But all your practices are not that far from here. Monmouth Medical?
Yeah. So I practice out of Monmouth at a Jersey Shore, which is the trauma center. So I do a lot of trauma out of Jersey Shore, and I do a lot of cleft lip and palate stuff out of Monmouth, and my practice is in Shrewsbury.
So you're always coming down.
I come down 4 days a week.
Yeah. You have the reverse commute.
I got a reverse commute, which is kind of cool.
I take the train from across the street from Monmouth.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. From Long Branch.
That's cool.
To go into the city.
So let's go back to your childhood, right? You grew up in a suburb of, I guess you could call it the suburb of New York City, right?
I guess we're all the suburbs.
We're all
suburbs.
You come out of high school. At what point do you start to think, I want to cut people's faces open? You know, like, where, how does, can you take us down that road, man? Because you go to school and did you know what you wanted to do?
No. I knew I wanted to help people. I knew I wanted to be in some sort of healthcare, but did I know exactly that I wanted to get into the aesthetic game? No, that was a process. My first memory of wanting to try to help someone was Dow Avenue School, grade school.
Dow Ave.
And I don't know if Chico Breckenridge is hearing this at all, but do you remember Chico Breckenridge?
I don't.
Chico
I don't.
Breckenridge was my grade. So Chico Breckenridge and I were playing soccer, and
Chico
on the blacktop behind Dow, and he takes a nosedive, and he's got snots and boogers and blood coming out of his face. And the first thing my instinct was to run to him. And meanwhile, everyone's running away. So then I didn't know, but in the back of my mind, thinking back, that's probably my first instinct. You know, my grandfather was a doctor. My dad's a pharmacist. So from that standpoint, I was always interested in the health career. Finished high school. I knew I wasn't playing football in college.
Right.
So I kind of had to make a decision, and I went pre-med. First 2 years of school were probably, you know, less than average, just kind of time management, trying to figure things out. No real direction as to, yeah, I think I want to be a doctor, but I don't know what I want to do. And then I started working with a guy in town locally in the summer. And, you know, he took me to the hospital, and I saw, like, corrective jaw surgery. Oof. And I was like, you know what? This is something I can do for the rest of my life.
Wow.
So I went from that. I said, what do I have to do? He said, got to go to dental school. I said, okay, fine. I'll go to dental school. I didn't want to go to dental school, but I'll go. Yeah, I mean, it wasn't really.
Means to an end, right?
Yeah, it was basically that's the way I looked at it. And then after that, I matched in a residency where, you know, I was at a level one trauma center in Long Island. We took care of gunshot wounds, car accidents, you name it, we did it. And at my time there, you know, we would put all these car accident victims and really traumatic injuries back together. And then I didn't possess that one slight little thing, which was, if I want to take a little bit of eyelid skin off of someone, why can't I do that? I just put a gunshot wound together and they look like a human being. Why can't I just measure some skin? And so that's what made me go down to Mississippi and really focus my practice on aesthetic facial surgery, which is a passion. I love it.
So
it's an art, essentially.
Oh,
definitely an art.
Yeah.
But what's amazing is that, like, I don't know about you, Mike, but I can't even put on TLC and watch someone operate on somebody.
Hell no. I wanted to ask you, when you go into with that doctor the first time to look at that jaw surgery,
yeah,
in your mind, something clicked and you were like, damn, that's awesome and I can do that. And Derek and I, we're like, we want to run and vomit on the floor.
I want to help people, but if it's, man.
How what is that moment like? To you, you know, recall?
It's an epiphany. I mean, I was at Riverview. I used to be on staff at Riverview, but I just recently got off. Just wasn't active enough. But going into Riverview, I would, whether my case was in that operating room or not, I would go down to that room one, and I would check it out, and I would try to just, like, remember the way that everything was. It was such an impact on me that I went from a average student in college to 3.5 for the last two years.
So it became your passion. It became something you were
totally changed.
Yeah, no longer work.
It was there was a reason for me to be there, and I'm not the smartest guy in the world. Just had to work a little harder. That's all.
When you go into these, and don't undercut yourself, man. But when you go into these rooms, Thin Mints, Junior Mints, which one works better?
For what?
Anyone? Nobody watches Seinfeld? Remember when Kramer dropped the junior mint into the guy's gullet? And he cured cancer? It's one of the best episodes of Seinfeld.
I'm going to have to check that out. I'm off my game there, man. I'm sorry.
Me too. Yeah, damn.
The funny thing is earlier when we were just talking to the people on Patreon with Manol, Dr. Manoli.
I like that. That's cool.
What hand do you cut with? And he was like, he's like, he holds out his hand. He goes, I'm working on facial surgery. I was like, damn, it's so steady. He's like, yeah, but I cut with this hand. Yeah. I totally butchered that and I stole it from Gene Wilder. But.
That's cool.
Are you righty or lefty?
I'm ambidextrous.
Oh, really?
So,
can you actually write with your both hands?
No. So I can operate with both hands. I write with my left. I do all sports righty.
Wow, that's interesting.
And then I'll pick up a blade with my left, but suturing and all that, that's all back and forth, and it's kind of interesting. It messes me up. It messes everyone up. Everyone doesn't know how to, like, handle me instruments, but it's all good.
So everybody listening wants to know, like, you're in the you did time in the emergency room. You still do?
He's seen some shit.
Can you share that kind of stuff?
It's probably very upsetting stuff.
I can share stories with you just because no one's kind of privacy's we don't talk about names and stuff, but I guess one of the worst things I've had recently is a gunshot, self-inflicted gunshot wound. Mm-hmm. Those are devastating. Good kid.
Lived?
Yeah. Unfortunately, when you try to do that, they end up missing, you know, and they end up just basically destroying their face. And, you know, it goes from, you know, someone who wanted to end it all. Now you just deal and forget about the reconstructive part and, you know, 9 hours to put everything back together and, you know, the 20 surgeries in the future for you to just get your jaw back into one piece. So from that, you know, those things, you know, there's trauma and then there's that.
Yeah.
And that will always kind of stick you.
How old was the kid?
Young, 30, you know, 30 years old. That will always stick you and that will always hurt you. And, you know, I carry that around. I mean, I've had 3 or 4 gunshot wounds, self-inflicted in my lifetime who I've treated. And I know every one of their names. I know everything about them. Yeah. You know, it's crazy. It's a really tough thing to go through.
Do you ever revisit them down the line? I guess you did multiple surgeries.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the crazy thing, no pun intended, the crazy thing is that they actually end up being some of my best patients because they're in and out of the office all the time. Mm-hmm. They're having a small procedure here, a small procedure there. They staff knows them, you know, and they just had a bad moment. And it's, you can't take it back. You just hope that you can be a part of that rebuilding and not only the reconstructive part of the physical, but you try to be part of that psychological. I mean, to me, I look at it as if I'm going to rebuild you, I'm going to not only rebuild you from physical, but I want to kind of help you through that next process. It's tough, though. You know, yeah, that's really good. It's draining on us too.
I can imagine, and not to like bring down the show.
No,
more,
I'm not trying.
Like, have you had to do that talk where you go out into the room and be like, "I'm sorry, we couldn't."
I haven't had to do that with. Oh, I've had to I do. I've had like to have the talk. I've had to have to the talk going wife, into husband. Surgery. Like, this is really serious. There was a case that I was involved. I got pulled into. There was a guy who had a necrotizing fasciitis, which is a really bad. It's a skin flesh eating disease. You ever hear that?
Yeah.
So it started from like a tooth infection, and you think that these things are just like not that big of a deal, but it basically ended up, you know, taking all the way down. You guys can see on down to his chest,
from
here down, the entire skin had to be removed because it was becoming gangrenous and just basically toxic. But you can't survive that. I mean, those are things that you just, you know, it gets out of hand. And, you know, so I had to have a conversation with a family member. It's tough, man.
How does something, in this day and age, how does something get to that level, man?
It happens. It happens. There's neglect. There's oh, I'll get to it tomorrow. Or I'm just, you know, I have a toothache. People don't go to the dentist. And, mm-hmm. you know, it's... you know, whether it's Jersey Shore or Monmouth, I every time I'm on call, at least one time I have someone who's got a neck infection that, you know, these infections can go from a tooth, they can go to your brain, they can go to your lungs. I mean, people die from these. And, you know, it's crazy, but that's what happens.
Yeah.
You know, so I can go from a facelift in the morning and then be on call at the hospital. And next thing I know, I'm in like knee deep into pus.
Oh, come on.
That's what this show's about.
No, it is about. It's all about pus. Yeah,
it's all about pus.
That's what the P stands for.
Yeah, it's a P for pus.
That's a terrible word.
It's pus, gross. Pus Botox, and revolution.
So we do. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
The pus Botox revolution. Oh, man, that's brutal.
I'm trying to like run my mind through your day, man. We were bullshitting a little bit before.
Yeah.
A lot of guests that come on refer to our camera light microphone unit as like if Star Trek had taken a shit on a deck. Right? Like that's where my mind goes, you know? Yeah, right. But that's where my mind goes. Like I could never pick up a scalpel. I could build this. I could operate this. But I can never fix somebody's face after a car accident or a gunshot. Like
school goes into that.
No, I get it. But you know, that's where my schooling was in as well.
True, right.
You know what I'm saying? So but like you talk about like reconstructive surgery. So you get in an accident and your jaw is shattered. Now, how do you go about putting something back together knowing that this is just step one and then I have to let this heal and then step two happens? Like, what goes into that?
A whole lot of planning and, Yeah, it's just years and years of kind of knowing what works and what doesn't work, and just trying to like stabilize, and you know, you cut out what's no good and you build on what is good, and you know, it's just like sports, you know, it's the same thing.
Building blocks,
man. That's it.
And sometimes you after step one and it doesn't work, and you gotta just kind of reassess.
You gotta go back to the drawing board.
You got halftime,
man. Dude, that's the way it works.
I mean,
that's exactly. Yeah,
that's
inside joke there.
Yeah, that's crazy. But yeah, I guess you know it's a lot of practice and a lot of years of school and.
Right.
I mean, but yeah, I would never be able to cut into. I just can't do it. But that's why there's people like you that do what you do.
Right.
And you help people like us that.
Well, here's an interesting tidbit. I go, you know, I walk into my brother-in-law, Dr. Paradak. It's a little plug for him. He's a spine surgeon. He's in Shrewsbury too. But I'll go into his operating room when he's right next door to me, and he does spine surgery. So I'm sitting there putting faces back together. I walk into his room and. You look and you see like the entire back filleted open, and you're looking right down onto the spine,
that's
and you're
crazy.
Like, okay, makes me feel pretty weak.
And that's a whole.
But I just put someone's face back together, and he'll walk into my room and be like, "Wow, look at that!" Wow. So it's just it's just an interesting thing when you look at someone else's specialty or someone else's training, and you know, I'm sure it happens in every field.
Absolutely,
yeah.
You know?
No, that's true.
Let me ask you this question. What do you think about doing what you do? How do you feel about stem cell research and kind of, you know, regrowing body parts and harvesting? I've never had anybody on the show to ask this question. I'm kind of excited about it, but like, you must have thought about it.
I love it. I think it's absolutely 100% necessary. There needs to be obviously guidelines, and there needs to be, you know, rules and regulations on it, or else people are going to be doing some crazy stuff. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I use these types of materials, even though they're not technically stem cells, they're what we call progenitor cells, meaning they can turn into wherever you put it into. So if I have, you know, if I want to turn bone into more bone, I have a type of, it's like amniotic fluid. So, I'm wholeheartedly for it. I think it's the future. I think, you know, I think transplant surgery is great. But at the same time, if I can grow a heart off of some tissue cells that I gave from a swab inside my mouth, I'm all about that. That to me is that's the future of medicine.
I feel like it's bound to happen.
But why is it? It's not allowed to happen.
Well, it's not that it's not allowed to happen. There's just no funding for it.
So, how is there not funding for that?
Well, there's private funding for it, right? There's private.
There's no government funding.
Right. And really, the government, if they were smart, they'd back it. I mean, it needs to happen. You take politics out of it, really, but you just need to, you know.
I feel like, you know, like where we are right now, I feel like we should be able to, at least some people who are paralyzed, fix.
Oh, for sure.
Like, man. I think we could, but our technology now, I feel like how we haven't done that yet.
Well, I think the problem is, and correct me if I'm wrong, but there's no funding for it because of lobbyists and such, right?
Yeah, so political aspect.
Sure. Yeah. Like, they want people to have cancer and heart disease, and because it goes down to drugs, right? If no one needs those drugs because you could just grow another lung, you know, where's the money coming from? Right? I mean, am I way off?
No. You're not way off. I wouldn't say you're way off. I think that.
I mean, just not to cut you off, but I also think robots are going to take over the planet. But that's.
Well, maybe. So maybe I'm a little bit off. They might. I mean, I think the computer, if you take everyone's computer away right now, everyone will realize how stupid we are.
Oh, yes.
Like, take your iPhone away.
Yeah, like the amazing thing, this thing.
Lose your iPhone for 5 minutes, see what kind of like anxiety attack you'll have.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I do. What do you probably do everything on? You're recording me on your iPhone.
Yeah.
So
everything.
If we lose your iPhone, this place shuts down.
Everything shuts down. Everything's gone.
It could.
Wow.
I mean, you know, I argued that the end of the world will happen because of technology. And I don't know if it's definitely, you know, I don't know if it's the Terminator effect, which we talked about on the last episode, where robots are going to take over the world. But I believe that the technology will end the world probably sooner or later, maybe in our lifetime, because of misuse by humans. You know what I mean?
For sure. I mean, we're headed that way. So, I mean.
I mean, hacks become more prevalent every day. I get some kind of crazy email, or somebody hacks a phone or a computer.
Right.
The youth that came up. We got these cell phones. You know, Manolo, when you graduated high school in 92. I graduated in 93. Derek, you're not far behind, but we got cell phones maybe in college.
Yeah, yeah. There was no cell phones in high school.
No, we had beepers.
I don't know. I don't know who we were beeping or paging, but it was
each other.
Yeah, you know.
I mean, like, and then you had to go to a payphone.
You had to go to payphone to beep the guy right next to you.
I remember those. I never had one, but I was.
All right, thanks, dude.
I got a cell phone sophomore year.
Appreciate that.
Of high school, sophomore year.
So the point being though, the kids that are coming up, the kids that are in high school now. That were raised, they know no different than the iPad. If you show them a picture, they as a baby, they go like this on it. They try to swipe across.
That's
right?
Insane.
Those kids are so much more in tune with the technology and able to do things with the technology, to manipulate the technology, and that's where the problem's going to come in. And not because they're evil or whatever, and I'm not blaming the children, but they're just, it's going to be too fast and too strong, and eventually they're going to launch a bomb or a drone or, do you see what
that's,
you know what I mean?
That's... I don't even think like that, but you're right, because they can manipulate a lot of different things. Yeah. They're smart.
Sure.
They are smart.
We'll see what happens.
Now, in your field, like how much cutting do you see, whether it's when your brother-in-law is doing spinal surgery or when you're doing facial, how much is operated by your hand? You know, I made the joke about a shaky hand, and how much is actually via robotic
and stuff? In my specialty, there is there's like an encroachment now of some robotic stuff. But 99% of it is being done by my hand, at least for what I do.
Yeah.
There is the computer aspect and the kind of like the sci-fi effect of it is it goes in our planning. So everyone will go ahead, like if I'm doing a jaw reconstruction or I'm doing jaw surgery, I'll actually go ahead and get a CAT scan of the patient's facial skeleton, and then I set it up on a computer system where we actually perform the surgery
before
I do the surgery.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's all computer animated practice. Surgery. Well, it's not even practice. It's just saying, okay, I want the jaw to move 5 millimeters this way. I want to fix the crookedness of the mandible or the maxilla. Whatever it is that you want to do, or I need to make cuts here. So, and then what we do is we transpose that information that we've done on the computer, which is down to the millimeter, okay, actually a hundredth of a millimeter, and then we take that with surgical guides, and we relate that into the facial surgery. So
when you're actually really going in, you have a blueprint when you're going in.
That's awesome. Oh yeah,
it's like architect. You have your blueprints. That's what you just said that. yeah. Well, I don't know if I've ever brought this up on the show, but I've had facial surgery.
Okay.
I had a large birthmark on the right side of my nose.
Oh, very cool.
And I had it like my entire right side. And the skin on my side right here is now on my face. It went down all 7 layers. And it was plastic surgery, but there's no plastic involved.
Well, yeah.
But,
is there ever?
No, the plastic surgery doesn't, it just means to like manipulate. It's not really meaning plastic as far as like the material plastic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I looked a lot different up until I was like, I had my surgery summer after freshman year of high school. And because I essentially was about as tall as I was going to grow, and that's where my skin was.
So it was a birthmark, or was it like a meningioma or something like that?
It was a birthmark. It wasn't cancerous. They tested it.
Okay. Was it dark or was it black? Was it
dark?
Red? Oh, it was. Okay.
Dark, real dark.
So what did they do? They cut it out and then they put a skin graft in there?
Yeah, and when you're that age, you're like, oh yeah, I'm gonna wake up and my nose is gonna look like my skin right here.
Right.
So I wake up and I had I had a whole bandage sewn into the right side of my face, and it was the next day they took that one off, and then the next day they took the bandage off that was actually sewn into my face, and the doctor sees it and he's like, "This looks great," and I'm looking and I saw it and it was like the nastiest purple and gross, and I'm like, he's like, "This looks great," but meanwhile he was actually lying. He was just saying that to me. He thought it wasn't going to take, and if it wasn't going to take, they would have to do a different approach or something, but it did take. But My dermatologist was in Empire State Building, Dr. Kopf. Okay. I don't know if you ever heard. And then the guy who operated on me was Dr. Thorne. I forget his first name.
These are in Manhattan?
Yeah, in the city. And I haven't seen them since I was...
Well, your nose looks pretty good, dude. I can't really...
No, they did a great job. Very nice. Yeah, they did a really good job. It was a long time ago.
Yeah.
But it was...
Yeah, so you know what it's like to have a procedure on your face and...
It was intense.
Yeah, it's pretty intense.
Every day for like how many years I had to put this special stuff on it because they didn't want it to scar and get like a keloid around my nose.
Yeah.
That's like you see like the black dudes with like the branding on
there.
That's called a keloid, right?
It's a keloid, yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
And So yeah, that was, and my scar is like this big on my side because mm-hmm. you can't cut a circle and sew it up. So they cut like an ellipse or whatever.
Right.
And I remember that hurt more than, this never hurt. They cut wide open into my face, right. every layer of skin, but the side surgery is what hurt the most.
Yeah, typically the body surgery hurts more than the facial surgery.
Yeah.
Yeah, the face doesn't hurt as much. It swells. No. It'll swell up on you, but it shouldn't hurt. It shouldn't hurt too bad.
That was, you, did I ever tell you that?
Yeah, yeah. I knew you.
Oh, I told you. Yeah,
yeah. I thought it was your butt, though. I thought you had ass face.
Well, all my friends would joke with me. They were
I was
like,
waiting for the ass face joke.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. All my friends joke with me. They were like, oh, you're going to fart out of your nose. And but no, he got it from my side.
I was going to go a different route because you described it.
You want to see, guys, want to see the scar?
Yeah, show it to everybody. Oh, damn, dude.
Dude, what's up? You got to come see me and get that laser, bro.
You can fix that?
The nose looks good, but the scar that they took it from, it looks thick.
How would you fix
it? It was just a line
laser.
For a long.
Laser it right off?
Just laser that.
Chicks dig scars, man.
I know. I tried to scar myself up. Didn't work too great.
I fell off a boat. I got a scar over here. I fell off a boat, and that was a real shitty sew-up job. That's shitty. It's like this big. And I got my appendix scar. I've told girls before, like, oh, I got bit by a shark, and he like went this way. I'm like, really? Is that what happened? I'm like, get out of here.
I love it.
Did you ever do like plastic surgery on any of Donald Trump's, family? Because he's here. He'd like to talk to you about it. Because he said you did. Donald, Dr. Manoli's sitting right here.
Manoli, cannoli. He's an idiot.
Do you remember Donald?
I love Donald. Hey, Donald. How you doing?
How you doing? I saw you that one time. We were going to take care of this. You didn't do it. Vote for me. Trump, 2016.
Hey, Donald, I found a great picture online that you were sporting my hairstyle. You had a little man bun going.
Had a man bun. It was fantastic. It was fantastic. The best bun.
Yeah.
It is fantastic. It's a golden bun. Let me tell you, everyone in the world besides me, idiots.
It's crazy. Sometimes
I can't even believe he showed up.
He stops in from time to time.
How did that happen?
It's amazing. He actually has a real. I'd hate to beat a dead horse, but Donald has a really good plan about the wall. You know, between the United States and Mexico.
Yeah.
Donald, what are you going to put on the wall again? Just in case they didn't listen to last episode, you were going to put something on the wall after the Mexicans build the wall and Arnold Schwarzenegger throws them over the wall. You were going to put something on it.
I forgot what I said, but it's going to be something like, beat it, nerds.
I thought it was just going to be Trump on the wall.
Oh, Trump. It's going to be the most fantastic glass gold wall you've ever seen.
Yeah, for some reason, every time that the Don comes by, Schwarzenegger's not far behind. Would you like to talk to him?
Absolutely. It'd be my honor.
What would you, if you had to ask Arnold Schwarzenegger, governor of California, ex-governor of California, what would you ask him?
Dude, what the hell were you thinking? Having sex with your housekeeper.
Dollar for the time I've asked that question. I don't know. She was home. She has the large breasts, and I just couldn't help myself. And I'm what they call a sexaholic. She's gross.
Don, do you think she's gross? Don, you've met her, right?
Disgusting.
I don't know. Every now and then it happens.
How much sauce do you do, Arnold?
I did a lot. No, I've done so much sauce. God, marinara sauce, gravy sauce, all. Steroids, yeah, plenty.
A little Donald Trump. A little Arnold Schwarzenegger.
You've been going to those two a lot lately.
I know, I like it. You
got
to get. Oh, you know who
down,
I
am, dude.
He does. We got to get some new ones. I think it's time for some new ones. Breaking Bad's not even on anymore. You ever watch Breaking Bad?
Oh, I got to catch up on that, man.
Yeah.
You got to catch up on that, Doc. I could say you met some of your patients. And me and Mr. White will say you just give me a call. You got mad money. You're a doctor, right? Yo, Mike's a bitch.
Thanks. He always calls me a bitch. I don't understand why he does it. But Manoli, this music, this sexy music you hear indicates a game we like to play. It's called Top or Bottom.
Ooh,
all right. It's a game we play on every episode. I'm going to give you two terms. If these two things were in a relationship, which one would be on the top? Which one would be on the bottom? It's tailored to you. We're going to round table it, starting with you. You ready to play the game?
Let's go, baby.
Top or bottom, number one, intellect or athleticism?
Wow.
It's a good one, right?
Make me think, man. Ugh.
It's like NFL or a doctor.
Yeah.
Well, Peyton Manning's pretty smart.
Wow. I'm going to sound really shallow here, but athleticism is top.
Yeah? Why is that?
It's just such a... It's such... a big part of my life. Without it, I wouldn't have been able to do the intellectual part. So that's why.
It gives you the...
It gave me the drive. It gave me the desire. It gave me the determination. It gave me the work ethic. So without it, I wouldn't be here.
And you're doing some... To this day, you're doing some crazy athleticism.
Man. Yeah, it's high. I try. We're at 41, man.
I see you working out with masks on. And like,
you have that like mask that like...
I got the altitude mask. Yeah, my trainer is... CJ, what's up, man? You're probably not listening, but I'll get you in on this. He's a baseball player and by trade, 28 years old, turned 29. So I can't let these young guys beat me up. So he came home with a mask one day, and I was like, you get a mask? I'm going to get a mask. So it's altitude training. You can go up to as high as like 29,000 feet. So
it just cuts your oxygen.
It basically deprives you of oxygen.
My brother has a few clients. My brother owns a gym, and he has a few clients that wear it when they work out.
It's a sick workout.
Why does it help? I thought you want to get oxygen to your muscles.
You do, but you're depriving your red blood cells of oxygen, and it improves, it makes them bigger, improves the capabilities or the wanting of that oxygen, so that when you rip that sucker off and then you start doing everyday life things, it doesn't affect you.
Really?
Yeah, it's great.
I got to get one of those, because when I walk up the stairs, I'm out of breath.
You got to get a mask.
Derek T.
Man, I don't know. I've always been an athlete too. I work out. I think I agree that, you know, sports and athleticism and that whole camaraderie and everything kind of just feeds the other end of it too. Like, you know, clear mind. After you work out, you have like the clearest mind. Like, so I'm gonna go athleticism on top, intellectual on the bottom.
Is athleticism an intelligence?
Well, it's a skill and a.
You know what I'm saying?
Like it helps
So are you asking, do you have to be intelligent to be an athlete?
No. What I'm saying is is the act of athleticism and intelligence. So the fact that Michael Jordan can jump high, isn't that just his body having a more intelligent response to, I don't know, the twitch of a muscle or, you know, is it not its own intelligence?
I think you can categorize it like that. But I'll take it to one step further. I don't think that Michael Jordan was born Michael Jordan. Yeah, he has maybe some raw talent, but if you don't hone that, I don't care who you are, it's not becoming that. So his intellectualism is actually his sport, his training, his work ethic, all of those things that made Michael Jordan Michael Jordan. He failed. I mean, that guy failed a lot.
Right? I mean, anyone to get super successful, and you have to fail a lot.
You have to fail a lot. And it's not about the failing. It's about getting, you know, dusting yourself off and picking yourself up. And
I think it's like an intellectual drive that fuels the athleticism.
Well, where's the correlation between intellect and athleticism in, like, Wayne Gretzky? All right, why could he see the ice better than anybody else? What else would he have been really good at if it weren't ice hockey? Is it, like, an eye-hand thing? Is it you can break down situations faster than other people? Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So isn't it still...
It's definitely... You need to be great, you need to be intelligent.
I don't know. I've seen some guys talk that play in the NFL that don't seem to be too intelligent.
Well,
when it comes to the like sport hockey, maybe they're very.
Maybe verbally they don't talk very intelligently.
Right.
But
they can split.
probably football. Right. Probably football wise, they're pretty intelligent.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, they can probably see things, and they're intelligent in different ways. They may see visually. They may see things happening that you and I would take, you know, forever to see.
Yeah. Peyton Manning's a perfect example.
Perfect example.
Like the way he gets up and sees that. So,
So
I don't know. Like, I don't know how to answer this question.
It's a tough one.
I wanted to say like intellect because it doesn't fade, but then I was thinking, well, intellect does fade, and athleticism totally fades too. So I guess, I don't know, man. I guess, in our society, if I'm going to answer as an American, I'm going to say athleticism's on top.
Yeah, bro.
You know what I mean?
I think you're right.
Because
you agree with me.
Top or bottom number two. Well said. Top or bottom World Series or Super Bowl?
Oh, man. That's easy for me. I'm football all the way. Super Bowl, World Series. I was never a huge baseball fan. I don't know why. I think it just wasn't something that registered with me. But football for me, it's one game. You get one shot. World Series is seven games. You know, too much, too drawn out for me. You know, So, Super Bowl.
Yeah.
I like it.
I loved baseball. I loved playing baseball, but football is my top number one. I'm actually playing my Neptune alumni game on Friday.
What?
Yeah, we're not full pay. It's flag.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, Super Bowl on top, World Series on the bottom.
I mean, it's not. I'm not even going to entertain it. Although I do have a Yankee hat on. I mean, it's Super Bowl, clearly. I think, even though I do believe that the NFL is at its decline, I feel like it's dying from the bottom up.
I think the question should have been Super Bowl or World, what do you call it? The World Cup, soccer.
Oh, because you think soccer has surpassed, like, baseball doesn't even matter at this point?
I think World Cup. I don't think in America. I think World Series in America is huge. But I think World Cup, when the World Cup games are on.
Oh, yeah.
I think America's into it. I think worldwide, it's phenomenal.
Worldwide soccer is the biggest.
Yeah.
Here, football is the biggest.
I agree with that.
But, World Cup's on, man, I'm all into it.
I'm all 100% into that.
Yeah. I do not agree, though, with the World Series thing, because let me paint this picture. Okay. If Jacksonville Jaguars in the NFL play the Tennessee Titans, that can't even happen, but if Jacksonville plays Carolina Panthers in the Super Bowl.
I'm not watching it.
Yeah, you are. You're at a party where people are watching.
But I'm not paying attention.
But you're at a party and the game's right
on the TV.
Okay. If the I don't know, the Tampa Bay Rays play the
Kansas City Royals.
Are you watching the World Series?
No.
Not for one second.
If the Yankees aren't playing, I'm pretty much not paying attention.
If the Mets make it this year, you still don't watch.
But if the Cubs make it, I kind of want to watch.
I'll watch just because it's a New York team.
Yeah.
But I'm not like sweating it.
Yeah.
At all.
I'm with you on that.
At all.
I'm with you on that.
Top or bottom number three, performing or instructing?
Ooh, man, you're hitting me hard, man.
That's all about
you,
man.
I love to teach, but I love doing. So, performing is top.
Okay.
Teaching, instructing is bottom. But you have to understand something. When I perform, I'm teaching. Because I have a lot of residents that rotate with me and other young doctors coming up through the ranks. So typically my performing is usually involved with instructing. But I have to be doing it.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, instructing is fun. I actually spoke at my college this past Tuesday. Nice. Did like a whole thing, which was pretty cool.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, performing on top, instructing on bottom.
You have like this whole life that we never talk about. I don't know. Like
they asked me back. I did this whole this mashup event, and then I'm gonna go. They wanted to speak to. They really love the whole story and the whole vibe of it. It could be more than just arts and communications. So I wanted to talk to like a bigger student body. So,
cool,
so,
man.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I feel
performing
like
performing on top.
Yes.
I feel like instruct when you're instructing something, you're performing anyway.
Yeah.
Right. Like you know,
teachers are performers.
100%. You're on stage, man. So I got to say, performing is on top. I'd rather perform than instruct anything any day, even though it's one and the same. My next question was gonna. I'm scratching this one. You don't have to answer. But I was gonna say Grey's Anatomy or a bucket of shit.
Bucket of shit's on top.
That's what I figured. That's why.
What was the one you asked me? Oh, you're like Derek Sherman.
Oh, yeah. Every now and then when something strikes me, I always put it up against a bucket of shit just to see how it responds. But I knew you wouldn't like Grey's Anatomy.
I think I used to, but yeah, it's hard, man. I live that stuff all the time. So
is there any reality? Is it based on, I mean, come on, at this point?
It's so dramatized. It's like, I don't know. I stopped watching like years and years ago.
Mm-hmm. But, any medical drama.
Yeah. I mean, some of the terminology that they use is cool because, you know, they're like talking about, pneumothorax and the lung is collapsed and that stuff is cool.
Are you ever like, that would never work. Yeah, you're going to kill him.
I'm like, yeah, you guys are off a little bit, but that's whatever. It's fine. Yeah. It's actually pretty accurate. Yeah, it's not bad.
Well, they I know they consult a lot.
They do. They have a consult.
Oh, they have to, right?
Doctors.
No matter what kind of show you're
absolutely.
Doing. The real question is, top or bottom, Dollar Shave Club or Woolly Mammoth?
Dollar Shave Club or Woolly Mammoth?
God. I think we all know the answer.
Dollar Shave Club.
Dude. Dollar Shave Club's on top?
I don't know.
When is the last time you shaved?
I think you meant like nice beard or he's calling you a woolly mammoth.
I know, I got that.
He's a doctor, goddammit.
I know, but here's the thing. I get trims every 2 weeks, bro.
You keep a trim. You got to keep it right tight.
It's a solid beard, dude.
I go to the barber. You know, he trims me up. He twists my mustache when he waxes me up. It's all good. It's a kind of a, I don't know, man. My wife loves the beard, bro.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I'm digging the beard.
I like it, dude.
I dig it.
I'm not ragging on it at all.
It's cool. Yeah. You know, beard on top, bro.
Listen, if I'm going to be operated on, I do not. I want to be operated on. You know, you like. I don't want to.
I get some interesting looks for sure when I first walk into rooms. Yeah. Well, you know, it's distracting sometimes.
No, I think it's a sign. I think it's a sign of brilliance. You know what I mean? I think highly intelligent people have.
Who's it? Samson that had the beard?
Yeah, the hair.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So here, I had an interesting. I was at the gym working out one morning, and a guy working out next to me, he's like, you know, if I ever need anything done, he goes, I'm coming to you. I go, why? He goes, because if you can look like the way you do, and be successful, he goes, imagine if you didn't look like that, you'd probably be 3 times as much successful.
See, I don't know. And I think the opposite.
I'm like, I don't know about that. Exactly. I don't feel that way. I don't know. It took me a while. I mean, my wife has been my number one supporter in the look. She'll tell you, she's like, she created this, and she's probably right. You
know? I don't want a guy super clean cut, primed and proper, like taking care of me medically, because he's more concerned about himself than me. And I don't mean.
Oh, bro, I'm definitely concerned about myself for sure.
No, but you know what I'm saying? Like,
I mean,
I'm not putting down. No, I'm not saying you don't look put together because you do.
No,
but it's a look. It's a put together look.
Yeah.
That also says. You know,
I don't give a fuck. Can I say that?
Yeah, you can say whatever you want to say. Yeah. It's a compliment.
Yeah, I
don't think it's that a lot. I don't think we thought.
No, I didn't think.
I mean, you showed up in a suit. You're the first PBR guest ever to show up in a suit.
Yeah, I was going
to
say, fly fresh to death, that suit
hell
walking.
Hell yeah.
Slim
bro.
Fit.
I was working it for you guys, man. I wasn't coming in jeans. I was going to wear some cut off shirts, but then I was like, nah.
I'm in sweats. T-shirt. What was the question again?
It was Dollar Shave Club or Woolly Mammoth.
Yeah, dude, I'm Woolly.
Oh, top. I don't even use Dollar Shave Club. I haven't shaved the actual razor and really long. I just use like a buzzer because I keep it at about this scruff level.
Yeah.
So I guess I'll go Woolly Mammoth, although
I'm
very trimmed otherwise.
Oh. Yeah, I wasn't even talking about that. Eh? Come on.
Well, I don't know. I don't shave my face anymore with a razor.
Dennis! get Derek a razor. Every night I just yelling for our intern Dennis somewhere around here.
Where is that guy?
He's such a. You want to yell for him?
If Dennis, any, where are you, buddy?
Again, you see that? It's really amazing. When every time I ask a guest to yell for Dennis, they always yell the same way. I want you to just break it down for a second. Hold on.
All right.
We're gonna get serious.
Okay,
for a second,
bro.
All right. let me get
this real close here.
Get closer.
What's up, dude?
All right. You really need something from Dennis. All right. Mm. Now you need it now. He's not here. You got to call for him.
He's like your intern.
Give it to us.
Oh, he's my little whipping. He's my little whipping.
You got to fit your body on the table, face cut open. There's blood everywhere. Man. You need Dennis. How do you do it?
Dennis!
That's better.
How's it going? Better. How's it going?
I like it. I got to say Woolly Mammoth too, man. I don't ever shave unless forced. I shave my head every 3 days, but I don't use a razor.
Are you shaving because you feel like you're thinning, or is it just...
Oh, no, I'm bald, man.
Oh, you're bald?
Yeah, I'm totally bald.
Yeah, see, if I start to lose stuff, I'm shaving it.
Yeah.
Mm. It's coming off. There's
you
no
got long hair, right?
Yeah. It's kind of long.
You know, there was a Kickstarter for a laser razor. Anybody see this? They raised, like, 25 times what they put out for their Kickstarter.
It was a joke?
Well, they had no prototype, so Kickstarter defunded them.
Good.
But they raised millions and millions
of
dollars.
So where'd that money go? Went right back to the people?
I could go back to the people. Yeah, they just don't
I
fund
hope
it
so.
Out.
I wow. feel like not all.
I feel like they probably kept it.
So I feel like some of it was skimmed off the top.
For sure. There's no way.
Seriously.
Top or bottom number 5, elective surgery or mandatory surgery?
Wow. Bro, you're hitting me in the core.
Well, Manol, the
core of what I do, man.
The show is Pizza Beer Revolution, right? The pizza and the beers will get you in the room, but the show's really all about the guests, the revolution.
Man, you are like really sticking it to me. These are not easy questions. Elective or mandatory? Man, this is like dead. This is like radio silence. This is crazy. I think. Can I give you like? It depends what mood I'm in.
Sure, I guess.
How about when I'm doing elective's on top, and when I'm doing reconstructive.
All right.
So here's the deal. Personally, I get such great satisfaction out of doing like cleft lip and palate stuff and reconstruction and all those injuries that I was telling you about before. But electively, like that's where I love that. But if you had to like just chop me out. One or the other, I'd have to say, stick me in the necessary mandatory surgeries if I had to, just because I feel like those people really need me more.
How often do you say no?
Not
a good idea.
I probably say daily, and for various reasons. You know, people come in with some crazy requests. I probably have should have said no more in my life. A sign of a good surgeon isn't knowing when to do surgery; it's when not to do surgery. So I think we all have in at least from talking to my colleagues, we all have people that we probably wish we never operated on, and they're just like the albatross, and you see them on the schedule, and you're like, holy shit, I got to deal with this. But that's few and far between, and you just want to a good barometer is, hey, would I do this on my dad? Would I do this on my sister, my mom, my wife? And if the answer is yes, then you think it works for them, then you go for it. If not, adios.
Mm. I have so many questions off that.
Was it mandatory or elective? How are we supposed to answer?
I don't know. I mean, I guess.
Well, you have. All right. So how about in life? You got stuff that you can go to or shit you have to go to.
Yeah. And you had elective surgery on your nose.
True. So all right, elective on top, mandatory on the bottom. But if you need to get something done to live.
Right. That's mandatory.
That should be on top then.
That's on top. Yeah. I think that's on top.
Yeah. I guess that's on top. Elective on the bottom.
Well, you're looking at it from as a patient perspective. I'm looking at it as performing.
Yeah.
So performing's on top.
So you just talked about people coming in and doing some crazy things. What is the obviously no names, you could beat around the bush, whatever. Right. But what is the craziest thing that you did, and what's the craziest thing that you didn't?
Okay. Oh man, craziest thing I did.
And I don't even know if you don't even have to answer that question that I'm thinking about it. You don't have to answer it if you don't want to. What's the craziest thing you didn't? Let's start that.
All right, let's do that. Craziest thing I didn't do. Man, what's the craziest? I don't know, man. That's a tough one. There's
like a request someone came in with, like, can you do this to me? You're like, are you
Is that the
kidding?
Three-assed monkey?
Yeah.
You want a third boob? You can't give me.
You know, I get a lot of requests from women, younger women, to really like super inflate their lips.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird. I mean, listen, I do this stuff every day. So there's a certain amount I think is awesome. And then there's a certain amount where you start to look like almost like just lips.
Yeah, you're just like this.
Yeah, you're just all lips. And it's tough because they're going to go somewhere else to get it done.
Someone's gonna do it.
Yeah. And someone will take the money.
They want to throw money at their lips, which is whatever.
What do you blame for that, man?
What do I blame?
I had
for
a
that?
Different way of asking that question too, but I want to see if you're on board with me.
Like, a celebrity of this.
It is. I mean, there's this image that's on TV that, or Vogue or whatever, that every time that person wakes up or that celebrity wakes up, they look like the way they look on camera or the way they look on
zero chance.
And not only zero chance, it doesn't even exist.
Yeah.
Like that, even if you were to show these people, and I'm going to use Kardashians because they're
the number one. You do blame them.
Of course. I don't blame them, but you can't blame someone on TV for your actions. I mean, it's hard to do that.
I mean, but they have
taken it to a level of like.
And now the young one. The young one was gorgeous. Now she's just uglifying herself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Her lips are way too big. Yeah. It's like, what? You were pretty. Now you're making yourself not pretty.
Right.
Like, yeah, it's rough. Man, it's the worst.
It's a very fine line on what looks good and what looks great. And then with young kids, like 16, 17, 18 years old, you can for sure make yourself look older by doing this stuff. And that's not necessarily what you want either.
No.
So you have a lot of young kids coming in wanting to.
They're in their 20s.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I consider I'm young. I consider that young. I'm 41. Right. So I consider 20 young.
That's young.
I mean,
it's too young to be starting.
You can do certain things and it's fine. Like rhinoplasties on teenagers. I get that because, there's some, they feel the confidence is low, they may be made fun of. Doing a rhinoplasty on a girl and a guy or, whatever, when they're in like they're 16, 17, 18, I think that falls within the norm. I think corrective ear surgery for like kids who have really big prominent ears.
Yeah.
I mean, all that stuff, those are self-image things that can be corrected. But to sit there and do like big lips on a 16, 18-year-old, mm-hmm. whatever.
That's, they're not even done growing.
No, yet. No. It's and it's just not right. I mean, it's not right. I mean, that whole, what was that, shot glass thing that was going on?
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, it was ridiculous.
The something challenge. Who was it? The Kim Kardashian challenge?
Yeah. I don't know what it was called.
It was one of the Kardashians started it.
Oh, really?
Or it was after she got her lips done.
The it was the Kendall.
Yeah. Yeah.
How does it snowball through a whole family, man, and to the point where their father is going through a sex change, right? Bruce Jenner.
Yeah, that's pretty. Yeah, Bruce Jenner. Yeah. Man, I can't believe it. I still can't
believe
it. It's so crazy. Like, the guy, the way I see him is on my Wheaties box. Mm-hmm. I first started eating Wheaties.
Yeah.
You know, it was like 19. Yeah. I mean, that's the way I remember it.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's complicated. I mean, it's just not simple.
Is it a genetic mental flaw, or is it vanity at its worst? I mean, is it just that they are all competing with one another? It's normal in their life. I mean, how does that happen, man?
First of all, that whole Kardashian phenomenon, and it is a phenomenon if you think about it. Like, what are they actually, what?
Exactly. At the core, what are they doing?
What are they doing? I mean, they're just living their lives.
That's it.
But
their father was one of the attorneys on the OJ.
Right, on
their,
OJ.
Their stepfather was one of the best athletes we've
ever.
Yeah.
And, you know, but it's very complicated because, you know, they what are they offering? But then again, everyone's watching.
Crazy.
So what does that say about our society versus what does it say about
and especially,
they're just cashing in.
Yeah, especially for someone like me who's like a working actor, a working host, and a comedian in this industry, just like, you know, auditioning every day and getting jobs here. Well, obviously I have a steady gig, but like it's still a struggle. And it's like I'm working my ass off and along with a ton of other people.
Of course.
And they're just like doing nothing and just getting... You know, $100,000 to go to a club and go, oh my God, hit the button.
Is that not what is that not what they want people to do? The sheeple, right? They want you to sit home and eat bonbons and watch the Kardashians and get these cancers and not give money to Stelsem to fix your issues
because you're fat,
so you can pay the drug companies money,
rope everything
to keep their pockets.
You just roped it in, bro.
Is that pretty much it? And robots.
I mean, that's pretty close.
When did the robots come? When are the robots? Got robots coming soon?
Save the Robots.
After the cat genocide.
What was that?
Save the Robots.
What was that from?
That was a club in Manhattan.
There was a club called Save the Robots.
Oh, jeez.
What year are we talking
about? That was bad. It was a bad year.
Save the Robots. I don't know.
Ask Matty B. He'll tell you.
Shout out to Matty B.
Hey, B.
So I don't know. I was watching Saturday Night Live this weekend, and Amy Schumer was on it. She got a lot of shit for
making fun of them.
She made fun of Chloe.
Right.
Who cares? That's what I was about to bring up. I watched the clip on. I didn't see it, but I watched it on YouTube.
Yeah.
I thought it was great. She did.
Yeah.
She's like, we had Chloe. Us bigger girls, we had.
Yeah.
That's funny.
And then she attacked Chloe Fires back on Twitter, which when you think about it, is
you're typing 140 letters.
Like, she attacked on social media. Like, you have the direct. You know, 20 years ago, how would she have gotten?
No,
back
she wouldn't even known. She probably she didn't watch Saturday Night Live. She wouldn't have known. And. We didn't watch Saturday Night Live, but you don't need to watch TV anymore. You just get a Twitter feed or whatever, so you know what's going on.
She would have not known so fast. I mean, she would have probably known if it
maybe the next day if the paper picked it up.
Yeah, but you're right. It's like, and it's what are you, Twitter tough guy?
Yeah,
that's a true term, man. There are Twitter tough guys out there.
That's crazy.
Anything that's anonymous is irrelevant. If you're not going to, if it's not coming from you with your name stamp on it, it's irrelevant. Just it shouldn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's nonsense. You know what I mean?
Do you think that they tweet for themselves, by the way?
Not all of them, but I believe that tweet probably, yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
I think the Kardashians do. Like, because that's all they have is that social media. Think about it, the social, whether it's them being on talk shows, and that is their life.
Sure.
That's what, and that's their Instagram, all that stuff. Like, look at, I don't even know if Bill Murray has a Twitter, but if he does, it's not him tweeting that stuff. You know what I mean? Like,
I think that's a terrible example because I think if it is Bill Murray definitely is tweeting.
It's probably amazing.
Own,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
All right. But you know, like a picture, like a very prominent
actor.
Yeah,
I get it. Like Brad Pitt's not tweeting.
But
Brad Pitt has a Twitter and Brad Pitt's people are tweeting for him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The only reason I say Bill Murray was a terrible example is like Bill Murray.
Well, I just love
no
Bill
management
Murray.
Or anything.
right.
If you can get Bill Murray's number and leave him a message about a project,
he calls you back.
If he likes it, he will call you back.
That's insane.
That's how Bill Murray operates.
You need to get his
you
number.
Can't call his people.
He has no people.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, like, you have to call Bill.
I have a project. Can I fix his nose?
Does he have a problem with his nose?
Oh, he's got a big nose, man.
Bill yeah, but he's Bill Murray. I like, know. Right?
You can't mess with his nose.
But that's the thing. It's like
fix his eyelids. No, sorry, Bill. I love you.
Talk to me about the eyelid. You keep bringing up the eyelid. Is that like a fascinating thing to work with?
No, it's just a simple little thing. It's easy to say.
Who was the one actress? Oh, the actress in Dirty Dancing.
Jennifer Grey.
She had no surgery and then she wasn't getting jobs anymore. Yeah. It's because they look. Yeah, you know, it's that character thing. Look at.
She looked good.
She did look good. Yeah. She looked good.
Michael Strahan.
Yeah.
You know, that's his character, the gap.
Yeah, don't fix the teeth.
Yeah, not
he
fixing
won't fix
that.
The teeth.
He doesn't need to fix teeth.
Could you fix those teeth?
I probably couldn't, but I know someone can fix that.
Yeah, that can be fixed. That's no big deal.
You could just put that. Well, you break the jaw and you put it back
he
together.
He needs braces, man.
Braces, come on.
Pull them together, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people talk about like Barbara Streisand, right? She would never
touch her nose.
No, because that would mess with her voice.
Your voice, and it would have messed her up, man. And that happens. But if she did it before she became Barbara Streisand, no one would know the difference. So
right, and she might not.
She may not have had that voice, exactly.
Right? I mean, that's kind of how it works.
Pretty much.
Sometimes you get cast because of that those type of little nuances, how you look or whatever. You know, it's. Trying to think.
Of course,
there's so many.
You don't want to look average. You don't want to look normal. You want to have something that separates you out.
Sure.
Talk about separation. How do you separate yourself mentally from what you're actually doing? When you have someone on the table, how do you remove? You know, you can't go, oops, right? Like,
you can if you want, but you try not.
Have you ever been working on something? Like, oh fuck!
Oh, you can't. You can't answer just like, that. No, the answer is no. Move on.
Never, never have I ever. Never in the sense where. I actually fucked up.
But it was like a dramatic, like, this is bad thing. Yeah, you probably.
I think
you maybe know, you dropped the scalpel and hit the guy in the face or something.
No, I never did that. But you operate and in surgery, there's things that happen and it's some things are no big deal and then some things are like oh shit, the elective cases you don't really get the whole shit type of reaction, but like the trauma cases where there's broken bones and shards of bone and. Things that are just not normal and the anatomy's off. I mean, you can hit blood vessels and you're sitting there trying to stop the bleeding for a good what feels like 10, 15 minutes, which is only like a minute, but you're hyped up and it sets a tone.
Wow.
For sure.
Yeah. It's a high pressure job.
I mean, absolutely.
There's a lot of pressure on you.
Is there ever a moment like you're kind of shocked? Like you see something that you didn't know was there.
Yeah, it's funny. It's there's always something that's in a case that can pop up and shock you and be like, whoa, man, I wasn't expecting that, or I thought that was gonna go smoother or whatever. And the longer you do this stuff, the more you respect it, and the more you should always be afraid. You know, I kind of always have that little chip on my shoulder. You always want to have that kind of. Sense of
you gotta
urgency.
Keep you on edge.
Got to be on edge.
Combined, all how many years of schooling was it all combined?
Out of high school,
like yeah,
after high school,
you went pre-med. 13 years.
13 years.
13 years.
Yeah, I finished. I opened up my practice when I was 31. I started building my practice when I was 31. The door opened when I was 32. So that was it's wild, man. And the thing is that. You go through it and you're like, oh, it's just another, this, another that. And you don't realize how fast time flies.
Oh, mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah, I know.
The day-to-day is super slow because it's like, it's a grind and it's a test. It's a this, a that. It's, and then you turn around, 5 years are gone, 10 years are gone, 15 years are gone. Yeah. Now I'm practicing 10 years. It's like,
it's crazy.
What the heck just happened?
Yeah. Seriously.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Oh, man.
It's crazy.
All right, I got another game for you.
All right, man. I like games.
Do you?
Yeah.
We haven't played this one in a while. It's called The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly. All right, I'm gonna give you three names. This just for you.
All right, bro.
Derek, you can chime in. One of them's good, one of them bad, one of them is ugly. This is Good, The Bad, The Ugly, Under the Knife Edition.
Oh, I love it.
All right.
All right, man.
Number one, Good, The Bad, The Ugly. Sharon Osbourne, Priscilla Presley, or Courtney Love?
Wow.
And never once did we really think about, what if he doesn't know who these people are?
No.
When we put this game together. So if you have questions, we can just, Dennis! Get the cue cards.
All right. Give me the three games again.
These three are Sharon Osbourne, Priscilla Presley, and Courtney Love.
All right. Courtney Love is definitely bad.
Yeah, I think that's pretty bad.
Courtney Love's bad. Priscilla Presley's ugly.
Really? And you're giving Sharon Osbourne Sharon.
I was going to give Sharon. I'd do the same thing because she's like funny. She's like she's a ball buster. Yeah, she has a lot of plastic.
Priscilla Presley used to be hot.
Hot. Yeah.
Are we talking pre-surgical?
No, we're talking after.
Post retarded.
This is the under the knife. Yeah.
I shouldn't have said that, but anyway, sorry about that. But yeah, absolutely. After the knife, for sure, Priscilla Presley's ugly.
All right. Dude, can we get Ozzy Osbourne in the room to answer that question? Do we know Ozzy? We don't know.
Is Ozzy here?
I don't know if he's here.
Maybe he'll come.
Yeah, I don't know. Think about that. Yeah.
The Good, the Bad, the Ugly, Melanie Griffith, Axl Rose, or Donatella Versace?
Did Axl Rose have
Donatella? Donatella?
I said Versace? It wrong. I said 60%.
Right. Did Axl Rose have face?
Oh, dude, he looks terrible.
He did, right? I know he looks terrible. I thought he just got real fat.
No, he's just
dude.
He's
that right. That too, I think.
All right, who's the best out of all that? Jeez, I guess we have to go with. All right, who was the first one again?
Melanie Griffith, Axl Rose, or Versace?
Those are terrible nightmares, man.
Can you fix them?
Yes.
Where can they find you on Twitter?
I can fix them, but oof. All right. I think Melanie Griffith might have to be like the best one out of all that. Mm. The good.
So she's the good.
She's the good. Axl must be the bad. And then Donatella.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll go along.
I got the same thing.
Axl, man. Oh, I used to love Guns N' Roses. Oh, he totally fell
just
off the edge.
A little patience.
So, yeah.
Nice.
I
love that.
That's an old one, too.
And Slash doesn't age, man. Look at that guy.
He doesn't.
He's but behind his hair, but.
Yeah.
On the Axl Rose thing, though, do you find a connection between people who kind of go off the edge and plastic surgery? Is there a connection there?
Go off the edge?
Mentally?
Yeah, like, of course. I mean, I think, you know, I think some people who go drastic plastic surgery, cosmetic surgery, whatever you want to call it, when they go drastic, It's a type of personality, and there's probably some imbalances somewhere, for sure.
Top or bottom, number three, Barry.
Top or bottom, bro.
So the good, the bad, the ugly.
Under
the knife edition. My bad. 60%.
It's okay.
Barry Manilow, Joan Rivers, or Michael Jackson.
Oh man,
Barry Manilow is the only one still alive out of that group, right?
All right, so
yep, Michael Jackson's alive.
He is.
All right. He also never had surgery.
And he's white.
Yeah, for sure. All right, who's the second one?
Barry Manilow, Joan Rivers, and Michael Jackson.
All right, Joan Rivers is probably going to be... All right, Mike's just ugly. I mean, he's just... He was ugly.
Yeah, he was a great performer.
He wasn't always ugly, though. He was
pre-surgery, pre-surgery,
he's
awesome. Awesome.
Right?
I mean, I'm a huge Michael Jackson fan. Mm-hmm. Huge.
Of course.
All right, so he's what did I say, ugly?
Yeah,
he's ugly. Bad is who are the other two?
Barry Manilow and Joan Rivers.
Barry Manilow's bad. No, hold on. Let me do this.
You're all fucked
hold
up.
On. Let me fuck.
Hold on. Manilow, Rivers, Jackson.
Right. Jackson is he's bad. Jackson's
oh,
bad.
And not for the
right.
bad.
But right. He's bad.
Bad
right.
isn't good.
He's in. He's bad. Okay. Then we got Manilow is ugly, and then whatever. She's
Joan
good.
Rivers
Girl,
is good.
She's good. Yeah.
I would say thanks. Joan Rivers is great.
She was.
She embraced her surgery.
She
made
did.
Fun of herself.
Like, I will tell you this. She. You look at her. She's a freak. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah.
But at the same time, God rest her soul. I mean, but she did it, man. She did it, and she did it right, and she used it as a shtick.
And she was hilarious. But also, it was her downfall. Like,
right.
I mean, I think the doctors kind of messed up, right? I don't know the whole story, but...
I don't know the whole story either. You probably won't get the whole story ever.
Yeah, it was something like she bled out or something on the table, which shouldn't happen when you're getting fake something.
But she was having something done with her throat.
Throat or something.
That's right. She died from it all. I forgot.
Yeah.
Like, it was a surgery she didn't need, put it that way.
Right.
Elected
top or bottom, elected
top or bottom, baby, top or bottom.
Number four, Good, Bad, the Ugly. Kenny Rogers, Janice Dickinson, or Mickey Rourke? Well, that's a good one.
All right, so Janice Dickinson is gonna have to be the good.
Mm-hmm.
The bad is gonna be Rourke, and the ugly is Kenny Rogers.
I mean, Kenny Rogers doesn't even look like him, but Mickey Rourke.
Killed himself too. That's a tough category.
That is.
Mickey Rourke though, like he has a different look now, but it's getting certain roles and he's doing well.
Right.
But yeah, he looked way different. He was a good looking guy.
He was a very good looking guy.
He was a stud, man.
Yeah, man. And now he is terrifying.
he's a wrestler at all times.
Yeah. Did you see The Wrestler?
Yeah, great movie.
Yeah, great movie.
But he's also Park, man. That thing was filmed out.
Yeah.
He was also good in as the villain in Iron Man.
Yeah. Yeah, he was good in that.
Don't touch my bird.
Number five, Jennifer Grey. There she is. Goldie Hawn had plastic surgery. Why would Goldie Hawn have plastic surgery? I love her.
I think she did, though.
And William Shatner. The guy from Travelocity commercials.
Yeah, exactly. Shatner. He's ugly. He's ugly.
Do we know William? Can we get him on the phone? He talks like a friend of ours, Derek DeAngelis.
Hi. No. What?
Yeah, stop it.
Who's the other two again?
Jennifer Grey.
Jennifer Grey's good.
Goldie Hawn.
She's bad.
And William Shatner.
Ugly.
Yeah. I think we all agree. I think you win. I think you did a great job playing Good to Bad.
It was rough, man.
I think you won.
Yeah, those were tough. Those were some tough things.
I was going to say something. I forgot. Damn.
Really?
It was related to what we were. Obviously.
I like the music playing in the background, by the way.
Well, you know, you got a
classy.
Now, see, this one, now what we're about to do here.
Are we doing
this calls? What's that?
Are we dialing into the internet?
What is that sound?
Is that AOL?
What does that sound mean to you?
Dialing into the internet, bro.
That's how you remember it, right?
That's AOL.
This is a segment we call the Armchair Futures. You know, pizza and a beer gets you in the room, but the show's all about the revolution of our guests, which is you, Dr. Manoli.
There you go, man.
Right? In the year 2050, what is your industry going to look like? But before you answer that, Derek and I want to compete against each other, and I think I have an unfair advantage. Do you remember AOL Instant Messenger?
Yes.
Did you have a screen name? You must have logged on. Don't say it. But you must have chatted.
Well, not AOL Instant Messenger first. It was just AOL first.
AIM.
No, not AIM. Well, AIM, yes, but regular AOL.
Remember
in the
chat?
You
the
also
chat.
Had
remember
a name.
Your username. You know, like your tag.
Kind of, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
we're going to guess against each other what it might have been.
Okay.
You don't remember it, though?
You don't remember it at all?
I have it. It might be. Yeah, I might have it. I don't remember. I don't know.
Did you have another one
yes,
for
no,
AIM?
No, I do. I haven't. I got it. I know.
You got it? You know what it is?
Yeah, what is it?
All right, Derek, you want to go first?
All right, so were you always a Pittsburgh fan?
Yeah.
You can't interrogate him.
Come on, I just asked one question.
Interrogating? I mean, you can.
Well,
it's not really in the rules. If you want to interrogate, go ahead, because I do have an unfair advantage.
Because you went.
We grew up together.
Yeah. It's something with sports or athletics.
You talking about my AOL, my screen name?
Yeah.
Dude, come on.
When did you start chatting on AOL? You had to be in college, right?
I was a senior in college.
For AIM.
AIM, AOL, it's all the same, isn't it?
The
chat rooms, right? You're talking about
chat rooms? Yeah, age, sex, location.
Yeah, whatever.
No. Well, Manoli, man, that's a cool name. So it's not like Manoli Canoli. He wouldn't do that. It's like something with football, probably, or sports, or I don't know. So this is in college. You said.
You guys didn't look it up on AOL.
No,
history.
We don't. No. I've actually two people. I've almost said it exactly.
Really?
Name. Yeah, just pulling out of thin air.
He gets it really close. You want me to go first? You're floundering.
So you think I had something on football?
Well, no. Then you said you played football in high school. You said you didn't get a screen name for college. So.
It has nothing to do with football.
Nothing.
Okay, then I'm going to go with the first one. I don't think it has to do with college. I think it more would have to do with heritage and youth. I'm going to say it's like Karate Kid 92.
Not in college, dude.
What?
He wouldn't put that as his name in college.
Well, no, because Manoli he's a black belt in karate.
No, I know, but that was when he was a kid.
Yeah, but I said he would go back to his youth for his name. All right. You're right?
Well, don't say it.
My first guess was going to be like Assassin 6. Like, I want to say your number was 6. Was your number 6?
7.
7.
Close, man.
This is terrible for radio.
Manoli Man. I don't know. It's like Manoli Man or something. It's like Eminem.
All right, well.
Dude, you just nailed it.
Yeah, right.
Swear to God. It was M. Manilakakis.
It's amazing because he's gotten it. Like, we just started doing this, and he's got it almost every time.
That was close.
That was pretty good.
You worked it out. How do you do it, man?
How do you do that?
Did you research him?
I didn't research him at all. His name's awesome name, so it's got to be the name.
I think you showed your cards tonight. I think you've been cheating.
I think he's cheating.
I've never looked. I swear. I was thinking, because I was thinking high school, so I was like, you were big into football.
No number, nothing. Just M. Manilakakis.
M. Manilakakis, yeah.
Impressive.
And I don't even think it was the full Manilakakis. I think it was M. Manilakak. And because it was too long, yeah, so it stopped at the guy. Yeah. I was like, what? Yeah, it was crazy.
It was like an accident. But
yeah, but it was funny.
So I was like, I went with 60%.
So you're a goddamn winner.
Wow,
man.
How'd you do that?
I don't know.
He's nailed people down to the number.
I think I got a number once.
Like everyone always has a number.
I got a number once.
That's impressive, man.
So the year is 2050. You're sitting back in your reclining chair.
Yeah, that question again. Yeah.
Yeah. What does your industry look like?
My industry. I think that the aesthetic world is going to try to become as non-invasive and non-surgical as possible. I think when we look at industry as far as like health industry, I think, you know, we're going to be super computerized. You know, we're already starting to see these apps on our iPhones. Blood pressure, sugar, everything. So everything's going to be really super kind of like computerized. And I think by 2015, that's really only...
No, 2050.
2050. Oh, man, that's far ahead, man. I'm hoping we're doing like Star
Trek
record, scanners and all that stuff.
It is 2015.
Yeah, I know.
He's had a long day.
I know.
He's cutting open people.
Dude, I had a rough day, man. I'll go into that later. But yeah, I think 2015. Yeah, I think we're going to be doing some Star Trek scanners and here, take this pill. It's going to take care of everything. I just think that's where it's headed.
How far off are we, Ray Kurzweil? The exponential growth of technology, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where he says, and this was probably 5 years ago, so he's probably not far off. But in the next 10 years. If you don't have technology embedded into your body, you won't be able to keep up with technology. And he contends that they'll have, you know, blood cell sized computers that flow through your body freely to report. How far off are we from that kind of
zap like cancer cells?
Yeah. Well, just to report as it flows through.
Yeah,
the
just
blood
like as like monitors, like receptors.
Sure. Is that something that is that crazy?
No, it's not. It's not really crazy because, you know, they've already done like those types of things where you can go get things injected into you and then you go get a scan and it kind of tells you like where cancer is, you mm-hmm. know, or, you know, they're called PET scans. So, mm-hmm. so here's the thing. I think it can definitely happen. I don't know if we're 5-10 years away from that. I think that's one of those things that definitely by the 2050, man, that's crazy. That's, we're going to be doing stuff like that.
Yeah. And what about this? And they may, I feel like there's some form of this already. Like, all right, it's 2050. Manoli's in he's in California right now, but he's the only one that does this particular surgery. So we're gonna send him to a surgery hub. You put your hands in a thing.
Well, that's happening
and
now,
like,
right?
And it's
like that stuff can happen now because you can have technicians set things up, and then you can be somewhere else remotely coming in and doing the surgery.
Wait.
Mind blown.
But it's not like you put your hands in something, right? And you're actually
exists.
Well, you're doing remote surgery. I mean, robotic surgery is remote from you're not touching the patient.
So there's that, but there's a rope.
Yeah, I mean, there's stuff in the body. You know,
that's crazy. So that's essentially what I just said.
Yeah.
They have that.
And you can have people like logged in and kind of walk through. Other surgeons doing it, you know what I mean? So there's that exists.
Yeah. I knew there was like remote stuff. I didn't realize it was that.
Can the doctor in the remote area actually be operating the robot? I wouldn't see why not. Do they do that? I don't know if they do that because I don't know if legally that's allowed.
Yeah.
Well, when does the robot take over the job of the doctor actually physically making incisions and sewing up and you know what I mean?
As of right now, not that I know of. Can they develop software to do that? Yeah, they can do that. Absolutely.
Jeez.
It's crazy. So I think cosmetically, aesthetic surgery, all that stuff is going to minimally invasive. Hey, take this pill. It's going to help your skin. It's going to do this, it's going to do that. Hair, grow hair. you know, skin is good. Teeth are good. I think that's
the year 4000. If the Earth's still here, like all that stuff is going to be like, oh, I needed a new arm. I just got a new one.
Yeah.
For real.
Yeah.
It's coming.
It's a petri dish.
I just got a new right arm, so I just got to kind of get used to this hand.
Exactly.
Dr. Manoli, thank you so much for coming out, man. It was awesome.
Dude, I had such fun. I hope I didn't put anyone to sleep out there.
Absolutely not,
dude, it was great.
On the way out, anything you want to plug?
Advanced facial surgery. Proud to be an Oral Max surgeon. I don't know, man. I just try to take day by day and enjoy life. Thanks.
And that's at Dr. Manoli on Twitter?
It's at Dr. Manoli. That's Twitter. And then it's, what's it? At Dr. Manolikakis on Instagram and Advanced Facial Surgery on Facebook.
Manoli is M-A-N-O-L-I-S.
Yes. Nice.
PBR Podcast, you can find us on the web, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Let's give us some love. We'll love you back. You can find all Manoli's links off our website, and we'll see you next time.
This was awesome.
Thanks, man.
Very cool, man. Thank you.
Thank you, man.
All right.